or study, and that those who study these prophecies will receive an entirely different religious experience. Give us the wisdom, the knowledge, the understanding, and the discernment so that we shall steer clear of error and false doctrine, and that we shall make a commitment only to establish truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. We thank you that Christ is the truth, and he is the way and the life, and that knowing him is the only happiness that we can get in this life and in preparation for the life to come. So guide us in this evening's presentation. Let your spirit take control. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, last week we began to look at the three beasts. Before that, we had started that one as well. The three distinct beasts of Revelation, chapter. Revelation chapter 17, those three beasts, everybody remembers them? The dragon beast of Revelation 12:3, the sea beast of Revelation 13:1, and the scarlet colored beast of Revelation 17:3. All three have something in common, yet there are differences between them. All three have in common 7 heads, 10 horns. But there are distinctions in the first one, the crowns are on the heads. The second one, the crowns are on the horns. And the third one, there are no crowns as yet. All right, it's scarlet colored beast. Let's move on from there. Remember this picture, Revelation chapter 12, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, a symbol of God's church, pregnant, about to be delivered of a man-child, and a great red dragon about to devour the man-child as soon as it was born. That is referring to at the time of the birth of Jesus Christ, when the pagan Roman Empire was in power. And Herod wanted to kill Jesus Christ around the time of his birth. All right, I remember the woman fled into the wilderness, the Bible tells her. But then we are given a picture of another woman. A woman sitting on a scarlet-colored beast, Revelation 17, which is different and dressed differently from the other woman. One is a pure woman representing a pure church, and the other one, a harlot, a mother harlot. If she is a mother, she must have daughters. And the Bible tells us the name that was written on her forehead was Babylon, the Great, the Mother of Harlots. Now that Babylon, the Great, is not to be confused with Babylon. Babylon fell in 1844. Babylon, the Great, will fall when she establishes Sunday laws. And that is when the people of God are called to preach the loud cry, to call God's true people out of that Babylon that has been formed. And that Babylon being formed has to do with the image of the beast being formed, and then the mark of the beast being enforced. Hopefully we'll get a chance to look at some of the terminology. Revelation 17, we've already looked at some of these. All right. Let's quote Isaiah 2:2 first and then move on. And now it will come to pass about that in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains, the top of the mountain, and will be raised above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it. This is the New American Standard Bible. Now, this is the point I ended on. If the heads are mountains, since we have already established that mountains are heads are the same, if the heads are mountains and the mountains are kings, then the heads are kings as well. So we are talking about seven heads, seven mountains, seven kings. All three refer to the same thing. All right. So what are the heads? Firstly, the Bible tells us in Revelation 17 that the beast consists of the seven heads. The beast itself consists of the seven heads. All right. Imagine a beast with seven heads. Now take away the seven heads, and what do we have? What is left is a dead carcass. Without its heads, there's no beast without the head. Because a beast functions through its heads. And those who have had to raise goats or sheep or some of those animals that use their heads would know when they function what they do. I had experience in St. Lucie where I was raised, having to raise sheep and goats for my grandmother and take care of them. All right. The Bible tells us that the harlot, or the Babylon, sits on both the beast and on its seven heads. That's Revelation 17, verses 3 and 9. Let's read that just to confirm. Revelation 17, 3 and 9. I have to make sure that everybody is following clearly. Revelation 17, verses 3 and verse 9. Verse 3 says, Revelation 17, verse 3. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. Verse 9. And here is the mind which have wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. Do we have it there? So the harlot or Babylon sits on both the beast and on its seven heads. In Daniel 7, there's a leopard with four heads. Which power is that? A leopard with four heads. Pardon? Greece, right. Daniel 7 says, this is interpreted as Greece, and the four heads are interpreted as four Grecian kingdoms that arose after Alexander's death. Also in this case, the beast, the leopard, consists of the four heads, and it is not something apart from them. They are part of the beast. All right. The relationship between the beast and its heads is similar to the relationship between the image of a man in Daniel 2 and the metal it consists of. That's the relationship. Just so you have an image made up of metals, an image of a man made up of metals, and we have beasts with heads on it. The image consists of the metals, while the metals represent what? Chronologic kingdoms. The metals themselves represent chronologic kingdoms. Actually, there is no beast. It is only the heads that exist. In that case, Daniel chapter 2. The beast is the sum of the heads, and exists only through its head. That is, it functions or its career is through its head. Everywhere that Revelation says that the beast does something, how does it do it? It actually does it through one of the heads of the kings that is doing it. And that's important to understand. That's very important to understand. We have four heads mentioned on the Grecian power, the Grecian head. And we have a notable horn which represents his first king. And he was the head of that power. All right, so everywhere that Revelation says that the beast does something, it is actually doing it through one of the heads. All right, or the kings, as it were. That is how it functions. Secondly, the beasts follow each other chronologically. Revelation 17:10. And represent, the heads, follow each other chronologically and represent the exercise of the beast's oppressive rule through one head at a time over the course of history. So we're not even looking at false doctrine that the seven heads represent the seven hills of Rome. We're not even looking at that because we already dismissed that. Through one head at a time over the course of history. So the seven heads represent seven what? Powers, and through which the devil has worked over history, over the time period in the past. Each one in its own chronological order. And it functions through its heads, even though what is pushing it and giving it its impetus is the beast's body. The body of the beast. For example, the little horn. The little horn is a part of the fourth beast. It's connected to the fourth beast. It's driven by the philosophy and power of the fourth beast. And the little horn, even of Daniel 8, a notable horn of Daniel 8, Alexander the Great, is the one that is functioning through that fourth power's head, as it were. And that is the one that flew from one area to another and landed on the ram and stamped into pieces. That is what we're talking about. Oppressive rule, through one head at a time over the course of history. The heads can therefore be understood as seven consecutive phases of the beast. Is that clear? Each head represents a phase of the beast. So there's one beast, seven heads, seven distinct phases. But the Bible tells us about them in terms of past tense, present tense, and future tense. I want you to understand this principle clearly. Because sometimes people ask the question, how is it that we are told of a beast arising out of the sea and then hearing that one of its heads received a deadly wound and the beast stopped functioning? Because the beast functions through its heads. So when that head is damaged or wounded, what happens? The beast ceases to function. Okay. So the heads can therefore be understood as seven consecutive phases of the beast. Thirdly, just looking at a few principles before we go into the chart there. The term king represents kingdom. Example, Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel 2:39. Thou art this head of gold. And after thee shall arise another kingdom that is inferior to thee. So heads represents kingdoms. Represents kingdom. So the term king represents kingdom in prophetic symbols. Just as a leader represents his people. For example, Nebuchadnezzar was called by Daniel the head of gold, but explained that another kingdom would follow him. So in Daniel 7:17 and 23, the four beasts are first explained as kings, but later as kingdoms. That's in Daniel 7. Let's read that, Daniel 7. Because remember, Daniel is the counterpart to Revelation. You cannot study Revelation apart from its counterpart in Daniel. Daniel is the exposition of the prophecy. Revelation is the, just what I mean, the revelation of the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 17 and then verse 23. You have it? It says, these great beasts which are four kings that shall arise out of the earth. All right, verse 23. Thus he says, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth. So that's clearly establishing that kings and kingdoms are the same thing. Or kings represent the kingdom. There's a Nebuchadnezzar represented Babylon. Kings represent the kingdoms, called kingdoms as well. Fourthly, principle four. Many people find heads by looking at empires that precede the ancient Babylonian Empire, and they end up with Assyria and Egypt. What we are seeking to prove here is that such a procedure is not consistent with the principle that Revelation is built on Daniel. So if that is the case, it means that Assyria and Egypt are out. Because we begin with Babylon. And that is where Revelation 13 directs our mind to Daniel 7. Body of a leopard, feet of a bear, mouth of a lion, and then an ugly, terrible beast. Some people call a dragon. The dragon gave him his power, seat, and great authority. That is just to disprove that principle. That's not consistent with the principle that Revelation is built on Daniel. Some people end up with Syria as one of the first, then Egypt, and then they deal with Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, Rome, which is obviously a misinterpretation of the book of Daniel. According to this principle, one should not look outside of Daniel for the interpretation of the heads. So if you're going to look at the interpretation of the heads, you have to look in the book of Daniel and its counterpart in Revelation. I stressed on that for a reason, and I stressed on it sometime before. This approach is confirmed by the fact that the beasts of Revelation all have seven heads and 10 horns, while the beasts in Daniel have in total also have seven heads and 10 horns. Where are the beasts in Daniel 7? Implying a close relationship between the beasts of Revelation of Daniel and Revelation. For example, in Daniel 7, we have what? Lion, Babylon, then how many heads after that? The bear, and then how many heads? We're looking at heads. Heads or kings? The lion, the bear, the leopard has how many? Four, two, and two, four, that's six. And then the next head. Seven heads. And how many horns are on the fourth beast? How many horns are on the fourth beast upon its first phase? No. 10 horns. Remember, Rome existed first without the horns. The Bible says afterward that it arose 10 horns afterward, and then the little horn arose among them. So we have three phases of Rome there mentioned. Rome in its raw state. Then we have Rome in its divided nature. And then we have Rome during the papal period. So we have, if you're going to count heads in Daniel 7, we will also end up with seven heads and 10 horns. But that's just to show the close relationship between the beast of Daniel and Revelation. All right. This does not mean that the seven heads are the same as the seven heads of the beast of Daniel 7. Does not mean that. Daniel's third empire, Greece, had four heads. If the seven heads of Revelation's beast were the same as the seven heads of the beast of Daniel 7, then the third to sixth heads would be the four Grecian empires which existed simultaneously, that is at the same time. And this would be inconsistent with Revelation because according to Revelation 17:10, the sixth head follows in time after the fifth. The sixth head follows after the fifth, according to Revelation 17. First five heads. On the basis of the principle discussed, that we should identify the heads from the beasts in Daniel, the four beasts in Daniel are the first four heads. And they are Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. First four, we've already established that. Remember these symbols? Lion, a bear, a leopard, and an ugly, terrible beast. All right. The dragon with seven heads, Revelation 12, is identified primarily as Satan. But that identification is in the context of the war in heaven. Remember I told you, I think it was last week, that the counterpart to Revelation 12 is found in that prophecy of Genesis 3:15, where we find some of the same entities being mentioned like a woman, the woman's seed, the dragon's seed, a war that will exist between them, and that kind of language. And the Bible uses that same kind of language in Revelation 12, 17. And the dragon, which is the dragon seed, was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, again, which keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And last week I mentioned that that seed of the woman has always been in conflict with the seed of the serpent or the seed of the dragon. There's always been war from the time of Cain and Abel, the sons of Seth versus the daughters with the children of Cain, as it were. And we have that all the way down, even to Abraham with the builders of the tower, right down the line. And that conflict will end in the book of Revelation between the seed of the woman and the serpent seed. Remember the serpent is that old serpent called the devil and Satan, but he works through individuals to destroy God's church and God's people. That has always been Satan's plan. So right through history, we have what we can call a very satanic, religious, intolerant, persecutory power at work through successive heads seeking to destroy God's people. It is known as the beast. Beastly in nature, persecutory, intolerant of religious convictions and persuasion. Religious, intolerant, persecutory power. That is what is meant by the beast. I repeat again. By the beast is meant that religious, intolerant, persecutory, satanic power that has existed in the past through successive world government seeking to destroy God's true people. And in Revelation, all the books meet an end. And they will seek to destroy God's last day people. And that is where that text comes in, Revelation 12, 17. The dragon was wroth with the woman. So that prophecy that was given in Genesis 3:15 will meet its fulfillment then. And went to make war. So it is not a literal dragon. It is the serpent seed. Went to make war with the remnant of her seed. Who's that? The true people of God. Those who are born again Christians. Those who have accepted Christ's righteousness. Those who have imbibed the principle of Christ's kingdom. And went to make war with them, those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Now the question is, to which seed do we belong? Those who demonstrate hatred and animosity and anger and schism and confusion, they belong to a different seed than the woman's seed. Remember, the promise was made in terms of faith was made to Abraham and to his seed, which is Christ. And all those who are in Christ are part of Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. That is biblical, Galatians chapter 3. All right, so back here again. So, when it stands before the woman, that is the identification of the dragon, when it stands before the woman that carries the promised child, it has seven heads, Revelation 12, 3 and 4, which are seven kings. But you may say, but all of the kings weren't manifested when Christ was born. That's the question you may ask. In that context, it therefore also represents an earthly power. In particular, it represents Rome, the fourth beast of Daniel 7, because that was the empire ruling at the birth of Jesus. On the basis of the principle above, namely, that the beasts of Revelation are actually heads it is confirmed that Rome is one of the heads. All right. So Satan functions through the heads to manifest the beastly nature. There's a question.
Yeah, I was just talking about the reports you are talking about recently, about the pass away and various dates and so forth. So I want to know when you actually get into that subject concerning the reports and the dates.
I'm not understanding the question.
You know the poems that you was talking about recently? The poems that are like John Paul and various poems that has been passed away or dead. I want to know if you can show this section concerning the poems that has been passed away and the certain days that they have been born and how long the poems has been and so forth. If you can show those things now or you can show them those things later on.
All right, let me just mention that there are some people who teach that the seven heads are seven popes and that they exist on the beast, which they believe.
I want to know how popes that exist already. How popes that existed already? How popes are this day and how popes are dead? I want to know the names and the pull-ups and the dates and so on.
We are past seven by now. They are past seven last week, I think it is. I mentioned that there were a number of pull-ups over the years. We have Pope Pius the 11th, and I have the dates in which they reign, all right? 1923 to 1939. Pius the 12th, 1939 to 58. John the 23rd from 1958 to 63.
I mean, can't really like all those things right now. If you could like put them on the paper for me, because I'm going to internet home. Gentlemen, tell me that we got internet home. I tell you that I'm going to internet home to show these various ports and such like. So if you could like break down or for the congregation, not for me actually, for the congregation in general, just put it on the board here that people know about the ports and so forth that has been passed away and the. What time we're living in and what Pope know that we have to come after this Pope, whatever.
All right. We have already seen that that's false doctrine and that we are down to the eighth Pope now, which is Pope Francis. And the prophecy does not talk about the Popes at all. It is talking about seven successive governments that were chronological in order. And we are about to look at how five are fallen. One is and the other is not yet come, which is really consistent with the book of Daniel and interpreted by the book of Revelation. So we don't get distracted with that at all. All right? So back to this. On the basis of the principle above, namely that the beasts of Revelation are actually heads, it is confirmed that Rome is one of the heads. Let's move on. The beast that comes out of the sea with seven heads, which we call the sea beasts, that inherit from the four other animals. That is Revelation 13. We've already looked at that. For those who want to read it, you can turn to Revelation 13. The sea beast arises. Obviously, it's called the beast that arises from the sea. The masses of the people, having seven heads and ten horns, and it inherits from the four other beast animals a number of characteristics. Body of a leopard, meaning that the body of its philosophy will be Greek, largely. If you study ever studied Greek philosophy, you will know what I mean. Body of a leopard, feet of a bear, mouth of a lion, and then we are told that the dragon gave this power his power, seat, and great authority. So we have four mentioned, and this fourth one, which of the dragon gives to this fifth one his power, seat, and great authority. In Revelation 12, we know that the dragon primarily represents Satan, secondarily represents pagan Rome. So pagan Rome gives the papal Rome its power, its seat, and great authority. And that is when the emperors passed on their authority to the bishops of Rome. And a decree was made by Justinian that upon the driving out of the three Arian powers, that the bishop of Rome would be made head of all the churches. And that occurred in 538 AD. All right? So, we have the composite beast now. A composite beast. But then the Bible mentions, all right? And the beast which I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were like those of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion, and the dragon gave him. That is this beast. It's not talking about the head yet. It's talking about the beast. Give him, this beast, his power and seat and great authority. All right. Then we are told, of course, that one of the heads was wounded. Anyhow, the leopard, the bear, the lion are the first three animals in Daniel 7. The fourth animal in Daniel is not compared to any known animal, but it's described as dreadful and terrible and extremely strong, and it had large iron teeth. Daniel 7:7. This sounds like a dragon. The sea beast therefore inherits from each of the four beasts in Daniel. The sea beast can also be called the 11th horn. Why do I call that? Growing out of Daniel's fourth empire. Now, you remember Daniel mentioned 10 horns. And then after those 10 horns, there's mention of a little horn. So after those 10 horns, there's mention of another horn that rose up among them and rose up after them. Some people call it the 11th horn. For certain purposes, now let's use that term, and then I will try to show you where we are in terms of that. Brother Steve? You got the mic? Mic here.
Just go back to the slide before. That the one before?
Forward,
yeah, that's the one. Right. The leopard, the bear, and the lion are the first three animals of Daniel 7. The fourth animal is in Daniel 7 is not compared to any known animal.
Yes.
And therefore, it is not compared. Your next sentence after that says it is called a dragon.
Revelation 13.
Right, okay. Now,
which comes from the dragon in Revelation 12. Because the only mention of dragon there is Revelation 12, just before 13.
The question is kind of strange, and it has been on my mind for some time. All the successive world ruling powers had their comparison to some animal which the people could identify with. But then here we have, you are saying now that the terrible beast is compared to a dragon. What comparison did people have in that time when it comes to talking about dragons? Did something such as a dragon that existed where you could say, well, all right, I understand what you're comparing it to? We're talking about things that we know, a leopard, bear, lion, whatever you want, cat, dog, whatever. How come you're using a dragon here now if no such thing ever existed?
All right, you're going on to, that's paleontology, right? Anyhow, the Bible mentions dragons. Both in Revelation and other places as an animal. I don't question the existence of them. I simply say that there's an ugly, terrible beast that is described, but definitely in Revelation 13 we are told, Revelation 12 we are mentioned that was a great red dragon. So obviously there must be some imagery that has to be formed in the mind in order for people to identify with. And it has to be something that has been known. a great red dragon about to devour the man child as soon as it was born obviously represents an animal about to devour a human being. Though we know that the symbolism represents Satan, that old dragon, a serpent, and so on, it does not deny that there was a dragon represented there in the prophecy. And the dragon was symbolic of something else. So all I can do is speak where the Bible speaks. If others can interpret it, great for me, but I can only stop at where the Bible speaks. All right? I came across a large book written by, and of course, the reason why I said paleontology is because some people believe that dragons came from the dinosaur line, which existed before the fall, and that they went into non-existence because of certain reasons, and some people believe they were part of the amalgamated species, but they never existed after the flood. And I know a gentleman who wrote a large book, I was about to buy it, but too much money, on that whole study, biblical perspective on the dinosaurs, whether they existed or not. Some people call we have something called the Komodo dragon. You ever heard about that? All right. We have some mysterious creatures found in the sea and some that had wings that used to fly. And archaeological evidence shows that there were some that existed in which they would have assembled the bones together. But I'm not getting into that now. But the evidence seemed to lean more towards the fact that they existed than not existed. All right. Okay, so we are the 11th horn now, if I can call it that. Some people call it the little horn, but let's call it the 11th horn, all right? On the basis of the principle that the beasts of Revelation are actually heads, it is proposed that this 11th horn is the fifth head, because the little horn represents which power? Papal power. Which power was it in Revelation 13 that received a deadly wound? The papal power. We've already looked at the contrast between Daniel 7 and Revelation 13. And we have seen that the characteristics of the beast of Revelation 13 are the same characteristic, including time period. 1260 years, or times and a half, 3.5 months. All of those characteristics, blasphemous. The nature of it is from the dragon power before it. The dragon gave him his power seat and great authority, prevailed against the saint. All of those characteristics are mentioned in Revelation chapter 13. So the little horn of Daniel 7, which some people call the 11th horn, is the same thing as one of the heads that was wounded to death on the sea beast, the beast that arises out of the sea. Let's go a little further. This is only for general purposes, but we will come to identifying after this, all right? The last two heads. So we have five so far. We have five so far. All right. I thought I had a mention listed there. All right, Revelation mentions something about the 11th horn, the sea beast, which is not mentioned by Daniel, namely, that this beast receives a deadly wound and recovers from that wound to become the worst, the most destructive force ever in history. That's mentioned in Revelation chapter 13. All right. After its fatal wound was healed, the whole world was amazed after the beast. Revelation 13:3. And they, that is everyone whose name has not been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, they worship the dragon and the beast. Revelation 13:4-8. This wound is not mentioned by Daniel. Your wound itself is not mentioned by Daniel. It is mentioned in Revelation chapter 13. And we know that that is on the fifth head, the one that succeeds the dragon. The dragon gave him, after mentioning the composite beast made up of lion, bear, and leopard, there's a dragon that gives this power, see, and power and great authority. And we know that the papal power received its power its seat and its authority from paganism. Papal power received its power, seat, and authority from paganism. All right? No, Daniel does not mention the womb. Coming back to that in a minute, Brother St. Mark.
Good evening. I just want to say, did the little horn rise up among the...
The ten horns. Yeah, and pushed up three upon its rise, Daniel 7.
So it pushed up three. So then the concept of the 11th horn, I don't understand the 11th horn. But if it rise up among them and was establishing itself between them, or it push up the three horns and then rise up.
In terms of numerical, there are 10 horns mentioned, then there's this other horn. Some people call it the 11. I'm just using the term there for... But it's really the little horn that pushes up three upon its rise. So there are 10 were identified initially, and then there's one that arose after them. Some people call it the 11. I'm just sticking with that term rather than little horn by itself. But I can use the word little horn. But it is the same thing as the head that was wounded in Revelation chapter 13. And I come into this for a reason. It is very important that to know that Revelation 17 indicates that the wound period, follow me now, that's just one of the methods I'm using, the other, the wound period, the period that the beast received its deadly wound, is the sixth head. That period, coming back to that, all right? We have the beast existing, the time that it is, and then not yet come, coming back to that. The womb period is the sixth head, the period of the sixth head. This is based on the following observations. What is that? A, the recovery from the womb is the same as the ascension from the abyss. The recovery from the womb is the same as the ascension from the abyss for the following reason. Coming back to this term in a minute. What happens after the recovery of the womb is the same as what happens after the beast comes out of the abyss. The whole world, not in the book of life, worship. All right, let me give an example. Open your Bibles with me to Revelation, Romans chapter 10 a minute. I want to look at a text, a very important Romans chapter 10. Find that text, everybody. All right. Romans chapter 10 and verse 7. We're going to read it. I want you to tell me what you think abyss means here. Romans chapter 10, because it's the same word used for abyss in Revelation 21. Romans 10, verse 7. Who shall ascend, or verse 7, but who shall ascend into the deep, that is, to bring Christ up again from the dead? And the word used there is abyss. All right? Or what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. So, the word abyss has been used to interpret, has been interpreted to mean dead, the place of the dead. That is where the word abyss has been used. Of course, other things that use the word abyss. But the question is, why would this dragon beast arise from the abyss, the place of the dead? Why would it arise from there? Because the Bible says it received a deadly wound, a mortal wound, according to the Bible. And that put it then in the place of the dead. Before it was alive during the 1260 days or 42 months. And after the 42 months, the Bible tells us it received the deadly wound and was killed. And the same word that is used for deadly wound is the same word that is used for a lamb as it had been slain. put to death. But in Revelation 17, this beast is going to arise from the dead, what the Bible calls the healing of the deadly wound. His wound is going to be healed, according to the Bible, and all the world is going to wander after the beast. So the same word used in Revelation 21, where the devil is bound for 1,000 years, all the wicked are dead at that time. And it is the same realm of the dead where Satan will be bound 1,000 years. Well, where will the wicked be? Dead. Scattered all over the earth. There will be nobody to tempt, nobody to deceive, because they will all be dead. It is in that confines that Satan will be bound. After the 1,000 years, the Bible tells us, all the dead are going to rise from the deep. The deep is the place of the dead. Satan will be loose after the 1,000 years. Now that's significant to understand. Because when the Bible says that one of the heads received a deadly wound, that means it went to death. Not only did it cease to function, but it was dead. The beast, that is. What did it describe the beast as? That religious, intolerant, persecutory, satanic agency. It functioned through successive heads, and this time it is not existent because it is not alive, it is not functioning. So, let's go again. So what happens after the recovering of the wound is the same as what happens after the beast comes out of the abyss. All right. It is quite unexpected that the anti-God persecutory powers go through a period of incapacity. It is therefore likely that the period of incapacity, not functioning, in Revelation 13, which is the wound, is the same as the period of incapacity in Revelation 17, the term wilderness, or is not, or abyss. Similar term referring to that period. The wilderness, where did God, John, go to see the woman clothed with the scarlet and pearls and so on? Into the wilderness. That is when the beast was not functioning. The place of the abyss. It received a deadly wound. Now, some people have asked about this concept of wound. How do we know that the wound, I want to deal with that separately, but how do we know that this thing called wound refers to the union of church and state? It was not the Pope being put into prison that was the receiving of the deadly wound. It was the removal of the power of the state from the church to persecute heretics that was the receiving of the deadly wound. We have a statement in the book, Great Controversy, that shows that Martin Luther, by preaching the doctrines of true righteousness by faith, dealt a death blow to the papacy. Can you imagine that? And that was long before the receiving of the wound, as it were. Through the preaching and the teaching of Martin Luther, a death blow was given to the papal power, for which it never regained. And then, when General Berthier was commissioned to go and capture Pope Pius and put him into prison, that broke the power of the state over the church to persecute heretics. That brought the papacy, to an end. What is the papacy? It is the union of a church with the state and using its power to persecute heretics. That's the papacy, definition of the papacy given in the spirit of prophecy. But watch it now. When the churches in America shall appeal to the state to get their power to pass religious laws, that will be the what? The healing of the deadly wound. The push for union of church and state, forming an image to the first beast, which is the papacy, that will be the healing, and that will be done through its legislation, because the nation speaks through its legislation. That will be the healing of the deadly wound. Union of church and state. All right, so I have here mentioned that the womb period is the same thing as the period of the wilderness, the is not period, and the beast in the abyss. Revelation explains both the seven heads and the beast in terms of the past, the present, and the future. The sixth head is the present head. The sixth head is the present head right now. Sixth head. But at present, the beast is in the abyss. The abyss period is therefore the sixth head. That's when it reigns during the sixth head. The abyss period. There's another beast that's reigning. The sixth head. It's not just a period. It's a power. All right. The Bible says, one, that the beast was past tense, is not present tense, and shall come up from the abyss, which is future tense. What's the time now? I have my watch. That's 20 past? 10 minutes past. I have to stop now in 5 minutes. The Bible says there are seven heads, Revelation 17, there are seven heads, five are fallen, one is, and the other has not yet come. Past, present, future. The beast was, is not, and shall ascend out of the abyss. Seven, there are seven heads, and there are seven kings, which are seven heads. Five are fallen, one is, five was, five are fallen. One is, the other has not yet come. Conclusion of this section. That's just, we're stopping at that point. To conclude, let us revisit. The heads of Revelation are limited to the beast in Daniel. You don't go outside of Daniel to get. Two, Daniel mentions five beasts, quote unquote beasts, if we add the 11th horn, which we must, because it is the main anti-God power in Daniel. We call it the little horn. And it is also the main anti-God power in Revelation 13, the sea beast. Very significant. These are then the first five heads. Those are the first five heads. Revelation informs us that the fifth beast actually has three phases, because it receives a deadly wound somewhere during its existence, but recovers from that wound. Revelation also tells us that the wound period is the sixth head. By that I mean, it is during that period, as it were. This results in the following seven heads. What are they? Just for sequence sake, because we have to tie in another parallel. This is just one angle, as I said. Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, Pit, Little Horn, the first five. Little horn mortally wounded in the abyss, Revelation 17:8. In the wilderness, Revelation 17:3. So the little horn is during the period of the little horn receiving its mortal wound, is during that period of the sixth head. And the question is, which power exists during this period? That's the question. Which power exists during that period of the mortal wound, the wounded period? All right, that's how we're going to identify the sixth head. And the seventh, what is the seventh? The little horn resurrected, Revelation 13:3. The time of the false prophet and image of the beast. Because this power is what? Does what? Gives life to the previous power. Where is that found? Revelation chapter 13, latter verses. It is this power, the little horn resurrected, the little horn resurrected. The power in Revelation chapter 13, second part, is what will bring back to life the little horn power. The little horn power will be resurrected by the second beast of Revelation 13. First, it will make an image to the beast. Then when you look at it, it will be an image of the beast. And then they will give life to the image of the beast so that that image of the beast can both speak and declare that as many as would not worship the first beast should be killed. So we are talking about what the spread of prophecy calls, in a word, a little flaw, the image beast. You know what the spread of prophecy calls, in a word, a little flaw? The image beast. You know why she calls it that? Because it is an image of the first beast, but it is living. It has been given life, and it speaks, and it persecutes, and it threatens to kill. That will be the seventh phase. All right? Little horn resurrected, time of the false prophet, and image of the beast. We are going to look at some of those. Yeah. I'm not following it. Revelation 13, second beast. Second beast of Revelation 13. It's not. All right, 3 and 4. Yeah. All right, very nice. All right, this interpret. All right, thank you. This interpretation provides a challenge because many commentaries hold that the explanation of the vision in Revelation 17 is given relative to John's time. This would mean that the sixth head is in John's time. We've already proven that to be erroneous. All right, I'll come back to this. These are the different popes and the time of their periods when they exist and the duration of their reign. All right, and we are past the seventh now. All right, we're into the eighth. All right, that is one phase I want to look at. I'm not going to go any further than that. Then we will continue looking at another angle. We're looking at the seventh head. This time, we're going to identify who exactly is the sixth beast, the sixth head that is ruling at this time while the beast is not, that is in the abyss. That's our next assignment, all right? To identify who that power is before we go on to the next power that gives life to the image of the beast and clearly identify where that fits in to Bible prophecy. That is United States of America. United States of America has a pivotal role to play in the establishment of the mark of the beast, bringing back the healing of the deadly wound. While people are focusing over to the Middle East, God wants his people to be focused on the second beast of Revelation 13 and what they are doing, because it is in the United States of America that the Sunday laws will first be passed. Agitated, passed, union of church and state, and then all other nations will follow in her example. I'm going to stop there. I have another point, so let us pray. God and Father, we thank you for this session. Continue to teach us what we need to know. Make us humble learners in the school of Christ. Be willing to listen so that others can benefit even from the presentation. Help us to be humble and to let you be our spirit and our teacher so that we can be guided by that spirit into all truth. Continue to keep us humble, teachable, open-minded, and truly to do our part in cooperating with you in hastening your kingdom. As we pray, thy kingdom come, may we allow you to form your spirit, the spirit of your kingdom within us first, so that the subjects of the kingdom can be made up and be prepared to enter when you come. So guide and bless and direct. Thank you for being with us now. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right, I think before we close,